So good morning all. We will start the session. Okay, we'll start the session. So good morning all. In the last class we were discussing about LED structures. So in the LED structure, we were discussing about a double heterojunction structure. So in the double heterojunction structure, in this particular double heterojunction structure, we were discussing about the two types of it. Okay, the first type is what? Surface emitting LED. The second one is what? Edge emitting LED. So in that particular, first thing we started, that is surface emitting LED, that is the diagram we have taken here. So in this particular scenario, what you can observe very clearly is there is a generating the optical signal and obtaining the optical signal out of it through the surface. Okay, that is what exactly the thing here. Okay, so here surface LED, the name comes why? Because we are taking the generated optical signal through the surface. Okay, so that particular provision you can able to see. So there is a fiber which is connected to the active region. So whatever the signal which is connected, whatever the signal which is generated in the active region, taken into the optical fiber. Okay, that is how it is going to work. So today class, we shall study about edge emitting LED. So what do you mean by edge emitting LED? Because see, the same thing. So everything is something like here, surface LED means what? From the surface, the energy will be radiated or emitted. So your edge emitting LED means what? Through the edge, from the edge, the light will be emitted. That is what exactly is going to happen. In order to reduce the losses in the and to make the beam is more directional. See, your edge emitting LED is having more advantages than the surface emitting LED. In what way? So yet in there are some losses which can be caused in the active layer when you are using a surface LED. So that particular losses can be minimized and we can make the beam more directional. We can make the beam more directional. That means what? What intensity of the light will be very narrow. So that particular thing we can make it out. So more directional. The light is collected from the edge of the LED, and such a device is called as what? Edge emitting LED stands for what? Edge emitting LED. So now, before understanding this one, we'll see the diagram of it. So this diagram is very important. Please make a note of it, all of you. I'll give you 3 to 4 minutes of time. Please make a note of it. It is very, very important. Why? Because as I told you, examination compulsory question. Okay, compulsory question this one. So please make a note of the particular diagram. So here in the place of see, you can see that there is a NPP region. Okay, that particular region is called what? Double heterojunction layers. So when this particular double heterojunction layers we consider, okay, so apart from these three layers, there is a substrate, metal contact, heat sink, okay, so strip contact, all those things will be present. So these, all those things, all other things will be considered as the supporting layers. The main thing is what? From the active region, the beam will be emitted, the light, generated light will be emitted. So that particular thing is like a torch. Okay, torch. Okay, so you have seen the torch. So torch is in 90 degrees to the surface. Okay, so that is surface LED. It will become, so when you make it vertical, it will become surface LED, and when you make it horizontal, it will become the edge emitting LED. So that's how the light will be projected. So, but when you compare to the LED and edge emitting LED. So edge emitting LED will, the way what we are going to take, that will be of more intensity. So okay, that is one of the advantage. Okay, so that is what exactly the difference between the main thing, that is the edge emitting LED and surface emitting LED. Please make a note of it, all of you. So in the right hand side of the diagram, you can see that in the active region, the angle, the beam will be generated and it is coming out of it like a conical structure. Okay, so please make a note of it, this particular diagram, very important one. So hope you have taken this diagram. So here, this particular edge emitting LED, active junction region, so which is the source of incoherent light, and two guiding layers being present. So here the refractive index of guiding layer is lower than active region, but higher than outer surrounding material. So obviously, the whatever the active region we consider, that particular active region should be like that particular active region should be like the core. Why? Because in order to transmit the generated optical signal in the form of total internal reflection, so whatever the region it is generating, that region should have the high refractive index, and outer surfaces should be having the lower refractive index, then only total internal reflection is happen. So whatever the light wave which is generated in the active region, that will not pass through. So it may be going through the cladding, or it may be going through the outer regions, So when this thing happens, so there is a waste of energy, the loss of energy is going to happen. So in order to avoid all those things, so what the structure has to be made is, the first thing is what the active region refractive index must be higher than the outer regions. So that is what exactly the first thing we need to do it. Thus, a waveguide channel is form an optical radiation and it is directed into the fiber. The below figure shows the structure of ELED, that is radio emitting LED. So your radio emitter's emission pattern is more concentrated and directional, providing improved coupling efficiency. The beam is Lambertian in the plane parallel to the junction by diverges, but it diverges more slowly in the plane perpendicular to the junction. So here what exactly the meaning is, so once it will be coming out of it, so once it is coming out of it, so once slowly, that means what, once it reaches some stage, it will start diverging, so like a torch light. So in the, when you take your hand to the edge of the torch, so you will get the round circle, that is plane exactly will get. So once you try to move the thing, so as the distance get progresses, the divergence will become more, that is in a conical structure. The same thing will happen in the edge emitter LED also. Here I can see that particular conical structure and all in the right side of the diagram. So this particular diagram indicates that yes, LED, that is ELED, that is edge emitting LED. So in this plane, the beam divergence is limited. So in the parallel plane, there is no beam confinement and the radiation is Lambertian. So to maximize the useful output power, the reflector may be placed at the end of the diode opposite to the emitting edge. Okay, so in order to avoid the divergence, so we may use lenses. Okay, so that what will happen is that particular divergence concept will be avoided. So now we'll see the features. You can go through the features one by one. So first feature, when you see this one, see, these are all the things I expect you to write it down. Why? Because it's a very, very important things. So linear relationship between optical output and current. Okay, whatever the energy which is generated, there is a linear optical output and current will be there. So here the spectral width is 25 to 400 nanometer. For lambda equal to 0.8 to 0.9 micrometers. So spectral width, when you're talking about, it will be 25 to 400 nanometer you will get from the edge emitting LED, ELED. So for the wavelength, 0.8 to 0.9 micrometer. So here, when you're talking about the modulation bandwidth, so the modulation bandwidth is very large compared to the LED. And these are not affected by catastrophic graduation mechanisms, hence these are more reliable. So that means what, as due course of time, so sometimes due to some internal properties, so generation of the electricity, that is the generation of optical power, may get reduced. But when you compare to the SLED and ELED, ELED will be having the more reliability by of time also. Some it will not get damaged, it will not get affected so easily. So that is why we can say that these are not affected by catastrophic graduation mechanism. The next feature when I'm talking about it is ELEDs have better coupling efficiency than the surface emitter. So coupling efficiency means what? Whatever generated power is there, that has to be transferred to the fiber. So when you come, when you are talking about the surface LED and ELED, ELED will be having the, that is edge emitting LED will be having the coupling efficiency. And then ELEDs are temperature sensitive. So this is one of the disadvantage also. This is also limitation, we can say. So ELEDs are temperature sensitive. So if any temperature is changing outside, that will get affected. That affects the ELED also. So now after that, when you're talking about the usage, so LEDs are suited for short range, narrow and medium bandwidth links. So these LEDs are very suited for short range, narrow and medium bandwidth links. And these are suitable for digital systems up to 140 megabits per second. So this these are suitable for digital systems up to 1%. And when you're talking about the long distance, okay, these are suitable for long distance analog links. Okay. So these are the usage of the LEDs. So we have discussed the features of ELED and the usage of LEDs in general. So now we'll go to the next topic, that is take the details. Okay, if you are taking the previous slide, please make a note of it, all of you. So you can always okay, I think the network problem was there, now it is resolved. Fine. So now after this one we'll go to the next concept, it is light source materials. So please take that in, light source materials. So now according to the shape of the band gap, semiconductors are classified as band gap and indirect band gap semiconductors. Okay, so that is the one of the important thing here. We are talking about the light source materials. So what are the different types of sources we have? So here direct band gap one type, and the indirect band gap second type. So these are direct band gap semiconductors we say, and indirect band gap semiconductors we say. So now what do you mean by direct band gap and indirect band gap? We'll see. First take the thing that according to the shape of semiconductors are classified as direct band gap and indirect band gap. So now once you take the this particular two things, that is direct band gap and indirect band gap, so we'll go on and understand the direct band gap semiconductor. So in the direct band gap, In this type, the electrons of the conduction band and holes of the valence band on either side of the forbidden energy gap have same value of crystal momentum. So here what exactly happens? The electrons will be at the conduction band and the holes which are there at the valence band. So this particular two things are separated by, okay, so some energy level. So now these two things will also have the same moment. The momentum, the speed is very same. So when this particular two things are there and we have the same value of crystal momentum, the direct recombination between the electrons and holes in the valence band takes place. So here what exactly happens when they are moving in the same momentum, okay, so those will get direct recombination. That means what? So they will combine each other. When they combine each other, they will emit the photon. So that particular direct recombination between the electrons and holes in the valence band takes place. So when the recombination takes place, the momentum remains same and band gap energy is emitted. So here what exactly happens is when this particular recombination is taking place, the momentum, that is movement, is same, but the energy, band gap energy, will be emitted. That means what? When the electron is jumping from the higher energy to the lower energy level, so recombination with the valence band is going to happen. So when it is coming from the conduction band to valence band, that will emit the energy of the one photon will be emitted. So it is having the energy. So like that, multiple electrons are coming from the conduction band to the valence band by emitting the energy. So that particular energy is taken, and that particular thing is called as the generation of the light, we say. Okay, so please take down this particular diagram. In the y-axis we have taken the energy level, and in x-axis we have taken the momentum. So apart from it, we have taken the conduction band and valence band. Conduction band is at the top and the valence band is at. So when electrons will be there in the conduction band and holes will be there at the valence band. So electrons will be jumping from electron, that is conduction band, to the valence band. So when this thing happens, direct recombination is happening and the photon is emitting. So this is what exactly called a direct band gap semiconductor. Please make a note of it, this particular diagram, and write the few sentences also. So once you take this particular diagram, we'll move on to the next one. So now after you understand the direct band gap semiconductor, we will move on to the next thing, that is the indirect band gap semiconductor. So here what exactly happen is, here also the emission of a photon will be there. Okay, emission of an, but here the concept is very simple. In this semiconductor, the conduction band minimum energy level and valence band will be having maximum energy level occur at different values of momentum. Okay, so your conduction band will be have a minimum energy level and see something like conduction band minimum energy level. That means what? There is a conduction band at the top and a valence band at the bottom. So the in the top we can see that the minimum energy level. That means what? At the edge of the conduction band, I can say towards bottom. And we're talking about the valence band, the maximum energy level at the top. So it, towards the top. So when these things are there, so when an electron recombines with a hole, and electron must lose some momentum, so it has the same momentum corresponding to the energy maximum to the valence band. So during the recombination process, requires a third particle known as photon with momentum Zk. So where Zk is the difference between the conduction band and valence band. So what exactly happens when this particular third particle photon. So when it hits the conduction band, what exactly happened? Whatever the electron which are there in the conduction band will be coming, which is getting removed from the conduction band, it is going to recombination with the valence band. So when this particular thing is happening, so it will emit the energy. So once it emits energy, so that particular energy and the third particle will move further. So it will hit the another conduction band electrons. So like that, the chain process is going to get converted, going to get happened. So when this particular chain process is going to get happen, so it will emit the energy. Okay. So that particular thing is called what? Indirect band gap semiconductor. Here, the momentum of valence band and the momentum of conduction band electrons are different. Energy level also different. But it requires a third particle. So whereas direct band gap, that is not requiring any third particle. So I can take the diagram from all of you. So here you can see the conduction band and valence band. Those are moving in different momentum. So here the third particle is going to hit. Please make a note of this particular diagram. So once you take this diagram, we'll move on to the next thing. And dear students, from 11 o'clock, you will be having seminar will be there, online seminar will be there, which I am posting on your AT group. Okay. So all of you kindly attend the seminar and make use of it. By that time, 11 o'clock onwards, one class which is there, which will not be there. Okay. Is it clear to you? So now, right now, I got a message I am posting in. So kindly attend the class from the 11 o'clock in the Zoom meeting. Okay, in the Zoom meeting, all of you must join. So once the class is over, I will also join there and I will monitor your attendance. Okay, attendance will be compulsory and don't miss out. And your subject teacher will also be present. Maybe Rajana sir is taking your class. So he will also be there and he will also monitor your attendance. Okay. So once you take this one, so next thing is what we will move on to the next thing, that is light source materials. So here in this one, the active layer semiconductor material must have a direct band gap. So in direct band gap semiconductor, electrons and holes can recombine directly without the need of third particle to conserve momentum. Okay. So in these materials, the optical radiation is sufficient. So these materials are compounds of the group 3 elements according to your chemical table. What you call a periodical table, something will tell now. So according to the group 3 elements, that is aluminium, gallium, indolium, something, IN. Okay, so then the group of 5 elements, that is PAS, there is phosphorus, arsenide, and SB, I don't know. Okay, so some tertiary alloys that gallium, aluminium, arsenide. So these are all materials which are optical radiations which are sufficiently high so that can be used. So you can make a note of it. So the ratio X of aluminium arsenide and gallium arsenide determines the band gap of the alloy and correspondingly the wavelength of the peak emitted radiation. So the emission of gallium, aluminium, arsenide, LED is shown in the figure below. So here you can see that the peak output when you are talking about, it will be at 810 nanometer. So we will get the peak radiation, okay. So below that and after that, we will not be having that much of peak radiation. So the peak output power is obtained at 810 nanometer. The width of emission spectrum at half power, that is 0.5, is referred as a full width half maximum. Full width half maximum, that is FWHM. So that is equal to 36 nanometer between the two ends, that is 770 nanometer and 850 nanometer. So we are taking that half maximum. So half maximum is what? The maximum is 1, half maximum is 0.5. So between the 0.5, how much peak we are getting? Okay, so we are taking that particular length. Okay, that is comes under, according to the graph, it comes under 36 nanometers. The width of emission spectrum at half power, 0.5, is referred as full width of maximum spectral width. So for the given LED, FWHM is 36. So you can make a note of this particular diagram.